my partner of 9 years, Matthew Becerra. We too want a marriage license. I want to thank Joanna DeRozzi and the Justice League of MSU, the LGBT Center here at MSU, for their work in setting this up today. Brian asked us to share our stories. I'm originally from North Carolina. I grew up there as a Protestant Christian, also being told that being a homosexual would be sinful, that I would be an abomination, that I should go through ex-gay therapy, which I did for 5 years, wasted a lot of money. But since I came out, I've never been happier, only because now I'm no longer living a lie. I am who I am. On January 31st, 2004, Matthew sent me an email. I'll never forget that day, because I waited 12 hours very impatiently for a response from him. Turns out the email landed in his spam folder. I never knew I'd meet my soulmate online, but I did. Our relationship has lasted almost as long, if not longer, than three of our family members' marriages. Our relationship. All we want is a marriage license. Civil marriages have nothing to do with religious ceremony, similar to what Mr. Campbell pointed out earlier. Have nothing to do with that. Our fight for marriage equality is simply that we want the marriage license, we want the ability to enjoy the 1,138 other rights that married couples enjoy that we are denied daily. In North Carolina last year, Amendment 1 was passed. I don't know if you know about this. The only reason I was interested in it, really, not only as a gay person, but also that I'm from North Carolina. Two-thirds of my state in majority vote voted for Amendment 1, which bans us as a legal couple in North Carolina, which means we are not secure in North Carolina. We're also not secure in Ohio for the same reason. There is no guarantee that if when we're driving through North Carolina, if we have an accident, that we will be able to visit each other in the hospital, much less make decisions for each other in the hospital. I called 10 hospitals between the Outer Banks and the Appalachians, and every single one of them avoided my question, which was, if we came to your hospital, would I be able to visit my partner? And they said, call back tomorrow. Go search for it on our website. I'm sure it's there. It wasn't anywhere to be found. We were being discriminated against in that moment. In the moment of dire straits, it would be even worse. Because unlike Mr. Campbell and his situation, North Carolina couldn't guarantee us the right to visit each other. If Prop 8 is overturned, we all heard arguments yesterday for and against it. If Prop 8 is rendered unconstitutional to ban same-sex marriages in California, there is a probability that the cascade or the fallout of that would ban those types of bans or would kill those kinds of bans, such as the one in North Carolina, which is a great momentum for marriage bans to fall in other states. It could also just possibly affect California, which is still a gain for LGBT rights in this U.S., in the United States. We unfortunately are not married yet. We are citizens of New Jersey. It's not legal for us to be married in New Jersey. It would be disheartening for us, as we see many of our friends who are married legally in other states, to cross our border and their marriage be dissolved by just driving from New York to New Jersey. That's unfair. It's unfair that our marriage, wherever it becomes legal, is illegal in our state. In our state today, if we had wills drawn up for each other, I realize that even with heterosexual marriages or legal marriages, those wills could be contested, but the possibility of ours being contested is even greater. So there is no security. Even though we're secure in ourselves, in our relationship, in our love for each other, deep as it is, there is no financial security supplied by our state. If Prop 8 and DOMA fall, there is a possibility that federal recognition for our marriage will be more binding in all states. We are currently being denied our fundamental rights as citizens of this U.S., which actually 15 times over the Supreme Court has said marriage is a fundamental right of every citizen in the U.S., and we are denied that. Our hope is that discrimination continues to lose ground, and our greater hope is that equality takes firmer root. Thank you.
Thank you for being here. I'd be upset. I don't think there's a gay worth their salt out there that doesn't have a sweater that is capable of handling this situation. You should be fine. Scarves alone. I'm not a, ask anyone here that knows me, and there are a few that do. I'm not a touchy-feely gay. I'm not an inspirational gay. All of this has been handled much better by other people that I've heard here today. What I want to tell you. The perspective that I come here from is that, obviously, I'm a resident of New Jersey. I've been a resident of New Jersey all my life. I've worked in New Jersey all my life. I've also been an employer of people in New Jersey. And so I just want to tell you why you're different and why DOMA matters so much. Now, I know that the Edith Windsor trial went to oral arguments, happened today, It's a mistake to ever try to predict what the Supreme Court's going to do or say based on the feedback that you get. But I'm sure some of you have already heard some of the oral arguments. You can't ever stop pushing. And if I don't get to another point, here's why. The reality of the situation is that in New Jersey, with consent, you can get married at 16 years old with consent. A couple of 16-year-olds automatically have more than 1,100 rights than you do. Magically. They just become law. Now, granted, they can't take their first drink until their fifth anniversary. They can't drive a car until their second anniversary, and they can't vote for a president until their second anniversary either. But, magically, they are simply worth more in the eyes of this country than we are. And it's preposterous. It's a preposterous assertion. But specifically in terms of employment, because I knew I was speaking to college students here. With employment, two things that you need to be massively concerned about, and I'll address this just from why DOMA is horrible for us as a community, as employees and as an employer. Number one, your marriage being legal in the state of New Jersey, and I firmly believe that we will overturn the veto. I firmly believe it. There's enough time and there are enough votes and it's going to happen. And New Jersey will have marriage equality. Fine and dandy. DOMA is still in the way. DOMA makes it so that, for example, if anybody getting a job in New Jersey, and New Jersey is a great place to work. We have fantastic employers here. But one of the reasons why you want to get a job is because the health care is most often in New Jersey either partially or entirely subsidized by the employer. The part of the premium that you pay for your health care insurance, sometimes the employer pays some of it, sometimes the employer pays all of it. And if you're married, but you're not in a federally recognized marriage, the part that the employer pays is taxable income to you. Your spouse is going to receive a tax bill on April 15th for a tremendous amount of money that you were not anticipating. If you're in a federally recognized marriage, the employer's contribution to your health insurance is automatically exempt from your tax liability. If you are not in a federally recognized marriage, it is not exempt, and it is included as income, and you will pay the price. If you're an employer, and I have been in this situation myself, I gladly and would do again, though I'm retired now, I gladly and would do again, provide benefits for couples that the government denied me. But I would do it again because it's the right thing to do. But understand that when employers are providing benefits to the LGBT community, they are doing so at a massive cost to themselves. Not only is the money that I just described to you that actually tax on to your spouse's income, not only is that money a burden to the employee, but that money is also a burden to the employer, and the payroll tax goes up. It's expensive to hire gay employees that have spouses. It's expensive, and it's difficult. And that means it's just easier to hire straight people, and that's wrong. DOMA does this to us, and that is wrong. It's also difficult for the employer to keep track of people that are using their benefits for same-sex couples. It's a tax burden for them on the payroll tax. It's a liability for them administratively. The government demands that employers keep track of who is using their benefits for same-sex spouses. There's a list, and you have to be on that list, and you have to have that list maintained, and that is how they keep track of the tax liability. And that's DOMA, and that's wrong. There is a lot of other reasons why DOMA is wrong. It's been described tremendously by other people here. Edith Windsor, God bless her heart, 83 years old, and she had to go and convince a panel of judges that she accidentally bankrupted herself because she inherited her partner's, her wife's, estate. We could accidentally bankrupt ourselves by inheriting from the loss of our spouses. Look, I know DOMA had its moment in the sun today, and we're not going to hear anything about it for a good long time by the time the Supreme Court writes their synopsises and the opinions, and then someone's going to write a dissenting opinion, and these things are going to take some amount of time. But we cannot stop. And I'm so happy to see everybody here that believes in that too. We cannot stop fighting for our civil rights because we are taken advantage of. No one speaks up for us except for us. And I just love the faces that I see in the crowd. Thank you. Thank you so much.